Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents This Vast Southern Empire, Slaveholders at the Helm of American Foreign Policy, by Matthew Karp, narrated by Tom Zingarelli. In the foreign as in the domestic policy of the United States, the interest of the slaveholders served as the guiding star. Karl Marx, 1861. Introduction. The World the Slaveholders Craved. The struggle over the future of slavery spanned the 19th century world. For centuries, the toil of enslaved African workers had formed the backbone of a colonial economy that stretched across the Atlantic Ocean. Then the great revolutions at the close of the 18th century, American, French, Haitian, unleashed social forces and political ideas that offered a sweeping challenge to slave labor. Over the next several decades, slavery's wide-ranging opponents, Republican lawmakers, liberal reformers, rebellious bondspeople themselves, achieved a number of major victories. Some New World states and provinces, from Chile to Vermont, abolished slavery altogether. Others, like Pennsylvania and Peru, took measures that aimed at gradual emancipation. In 1833, abolitionists claimed a further triumph when the greatest power in the world, Great Britain, passed a law that announced the end of slavery in its remaining American colonies. Yet, for all the momentum of anti-slavery politics, the three largest slaveholding societies in the world, the Spanish colony of Cuba, the Empire of Brazil, and the United States of America, remained firmly committed to black servitude. At the midpoint of the 19th century, all three flourished as never before, exporting unprecedented quantities of cotton, sugar, and coffee to the industrializing economies of the North Atlantic. British emancipation notwithstanding, the total value of trade in slave-produced goods nearly doubled between 1820 and 1860. By the start of the American Civil War, 6 million men, women, and children toiled in bondage, the largest number in the history of the Western Hemisphere. Although the transatlantic abolitionist movement declared with increasing vehemence that human bondage had no rightful place in modern life, the planters and politicians who presided over slavery's boom saw no reason to abandon the field. On the contrary, slaveholders grew increasingly confident about the strength of their position within the mid-19th century world order. In an era marked by global economic expansion and fierce political collision, the fate of chattel slavery remained very much undecided. As both pro-slavery and anti-slavery forces scrambled for advantage, the shock waves of their struggle spread far beyond the traditional nodes of the Atlantic basin. Farmers, migrants, merchants, and soldiers from Ottoman Turkey, Qing China, British India, and Mexican California found their worlds affected by the international contest over slavery. No wonder American abolitionists believed that national arguments about bondage had global consequences. "This question of slavery does not concern America alone," proclaimed the Massachusetts minister Theodore Parker in 1856. "All Christendom is likewise party to the contest." American slaveholders agreed. By the middle of the century, Southern masters ruled over the wealthiest and most dynamic slave society the world had ever known. If slave labor had an international future, they would certainly command it. Far from isolated reactionaries crying out against the transformations of the age, pro-slavery leaders warmly embraced the global dimensions of their struggle. A chief instrument in their endeavors was the foreign policy of the United States. Throughout the antebellum decades, it was through the operation of U.S. foreign policy that Southern statesmen mounted some of their most daring efforts to advance the international cause of slavery. The partial success and ultimate failure of these ventures, including the boldest foreign policy project of all, the founding of the Confederate States of America, played no small part in determining the future of the 19th century world. Not so long ago, it seemed self-evident that human bondage could not survive the mid-19th century. Of course, slave societies, including that of the South, were doomed, sighed Eric Hobsbawm as he settled in to consider the subject in the Age of Capital. By the 1850s, slavery as a factor in world history was patently on the decline, its economic muscle amputated by the spread of free labor, its social logic repudiated by bourgeois values. 21st century scholarship, however, has turned this verdict almost upside down. Slavery's massive mid-century expansion, its dynamic integration into the world market, and its brutal assimilation of modern economic practices have all received new and powerful emphasis. Older assumptions about the provincialism of the antebellum South have been demolished as historians have rediscovered the intellectual sophistication of the slaveholding elite. Few mid-19th century Americans were more deeply engaged with international politics than Southern slaveholders. A class whose main source of income derived from the global marketplace could not afford to isolate itself from the rest of the world. Compared with Maine dairy farmers, Michigan lumber dealers, or Pennsylvania iron makers, whose goods were consumed within national borders, cotton planters from Georgia to Texas were almost inescapably cosmopolitan in outlook. Yet the most powerful American slaveholders paid close attention to developments all around the globe in ways that went far beyond a desire to market their plantation exports. Southern elites kept the international politics of slavery under constant surveillance, tracking threats to slave property across the hemisphere and monitoring oscillations in global attitudes toward emancipation. They carefully followed the course of world affairs, not only the storms of revolution and reaction in Europe, but also the steady growth of imperial influence in Africa and Asia. They stayed abreast of the latest developments in military technology and administration, from British naval armaments to French infantry deployments in Algeria. Above all, slaveholding leaders sought to keep pace with the constant strivings of the mid-19th century world, the expansion of commerce, the march of empire, the advance of science, and the reshaping of state power. Neither flaming hotheads nor desiccated reactionaries, America's most powerful slaveholders were earthbound and waterbound men of the world, practical visionaries who, in Hobsbawm's phrase, thought in continents and in oceans. This does not mean that antebellum Southerners were no different from the other bourgeois elites whose ambition and imagination gave shape to the age of capital. Unlike London financiers or New York railway executives, the leading men of the South could not envision a global future without the fundamental institution of African slavery. Their continents were to be civilized with the enforced toil of dark-skinned workers, and their oceans were to be opened as highways to the rich produce of bound labor. But in the evolving world of the mid-19th century, the South's commitment to bondage made it distinctive, not irrelevant or obsolete. If there was little that was domestic about Southern slave institutions, there was less that was peculiar. Enslaved Cuba and Brazil were also booming, and by 1850, even anti-slavery European powers had begun to experiment with new systems of racialized and coerced labor, from Dutch Java to the British West Indies. For the Southern masters who celebrated it, slavery could claim a distinguished history, a flourishing present, and a glorious future. In both the American world they made and the global order they craved, Southern elites understood the growth of slavery as no more and no less than the true progress of civilization. During the middle decades of the 19th century, Southern statesmen not only imagined an alternative slaveholding history of the future, they worked actively to construct it. The ideological confidence and worldly sophistication of American slaveholders cannot be separated by their control of American state power. The name Hegel was first pronounced in the U.S. Congress by a Mississippi representative who quoted the philosophy of history on the benefits of slavery to the African race. One of the earliest congressional citations of Auguste Comte came from a Texan as part of an argument that slave labor was a necessary feature of global development. Slaveholding statesmen in Washington reached for these transatlantic intellectual authorities not merely to show off their learning, although that was surely a consideration, but because they intended to advance their theoretical reflections with the material power of the U.S. government. To fathom their intentions and to take an accurate measure of their strengths, we need not only an ideological, but also an institutional account of pro-slavery internationalism. That account must begin with the blunt fact of Southern power within the American state. In the two decades before the Civil War, pro-slavery elites and their largely compliant Northern allies maintained a vise-like grip on the executive branch of the U.S. national government, including the presidency, the cabinet, and important lower levels of federal administration. This much we know both from abolitionist litanies about the scope of the slave power and from careful modern scholarship on the pro-slavery bias of the early American Republic. Nevertheless, those old anti-slavery invocations may still have new things left to teach us. Since the slavery agitation, Iowa Congressman Josiah Grinnell observed in 1865, slaveholders have had the Secretaryship of State for 2/3 of the time, and for 4/5 of the time have the Secretary of War and the Secretary of the Navy been from the South. W.E.B. Du Bois later calculated that before the Civil War, 80 out of 134 U.S. ministers abroad hailed from the slaveholding states. Relative to its free population, the South held disproportionate influence in virtually every branch of the antebellum U.S. government. But slaveholders maintained especially firm control over what might be called the outward state, the sector of the federal government responsible for foreign relations, military policy, and the larger role that American power assumed outside American borders. Looking back, after years of brutal civil war, Grinnell saw a whiff of separatist menace surrounding the South's domination of antebellum military affairs. But in the 1840s and 1850s, slaveholding leaders did not assume cabinet posts to prepare for a coming conflict of arms, or even to augment their sectional strength in a divided Union. Instead, they sought with terrific ambition to command the power of the entire United States, and then, crucially, to use that power in world politics. International in aspiration, slaveholding leaders were profoundly national in operation. As early as 1922, Arthur Schlesinger dismissed the notion that the South's antebellum commitment to limited government had meaning beyond the necessarily defensive tactics of a political minority. Throughout American history, he wrote, the group advocating state rights at any period have sought its shelter in much the same spirit that a Western pioneer seeks his storm cellar when a tornado is raging. Plenty of issues in antebellum politics sent Southerners rushing to the storm cellar of states' rights. The power of the central government in domestic affairs, many believed, could threaten the sovereignty of masters over the enslaved people they held as property. But when the question involved the national government's direct relationship to slavery, Southern elites were more tornado than pioneer. In debates over the congressional gag rule on abolitionist petitions, fugitive slave laws, and other issues, slaveholders eagerly embraced the pro-slavery clout of the federal government. Between the slave power and states' rights, there was no necessary connection, argued Henry Adams in 1882. Whenever a question arose of extending or protecting slavery, the slaveholders became friends of centralized power and used that dangerous weapon with a kind of frenzy. Nowhere did slaveholders wield their power with more energy or commitment than in the realm of foreign and military policy. As executive officers, legislators, diplomats, military commanders, and journalists, influential Southern elites worked to build a vigorous U.S. government that could pursue significant objectives abroad. The two warmest friends of centralized power in all antebellum foreign affairs were Secretary of State John C. Calhoun of South Carolina and President James K. Polk of Tennessee. The two most ambitious reformers of the antebellum armed forces were Secretary of the Navy Abel Upshur of Virginia and Secretary of War Jefferson Davis of Mississippi. It may be tempting to regard this embrace of federal power as a clear proof that all Southern political ideas were no more than hypocritical justifications for slave property. Mr. Calhoun, as one Richmond editor wrote of the famous states' rights champion, was the master and not the slave of theories. But the pro-slavery effort to build a strong outward state differed from the South's parallel support for the gag rule or fugitive slave laws. In foreign and military policy, slaveholders summoned federal authority not only to secure their immediate property rights, but also to extend the power of the United States on an international stage. This was not hypocrisy. It was ideology, and strategy, too. The master theorists of the master class did not demand a rigid or slavish obedience to the principle of local sovereignty. Rather, they sought to consolidate pro-slavery forces for a larger struggle that spanned the Atlantic world. The wealth and power of the United States counted among slavery's most important strategic assets, especially in the Western Hemisphere, where the growing North American Union loomed over the younger and smaller republics to its south. Traditionally, historians have tended to assume that slaveholders' chief interest in Latin America lay in gobbling it up. Southern hunger for more slave territory, whether in the Caribbean basin or in the continental Southwest, has long figured as the centerpiece of pro-slavery foreign policy. From the perspective of domestic politics, this makes perfect sense. The Civil War emerged from a conflict over the extension of slavery. but as an interpretation of the way slaveholding leaders viewed the world, it leaves something to be desired. The most pronounced characteristic of pro-slavery foreign policy was neither a ravenous quest for fresh slave territory nor a desperate search for possible new slave states. Over and above these desires stood the need to protect systems of slave property across the hemisphere. After all, American soil was not the only slave soil. The United States was not the only slave state. Southern elites showed special concern for their fellow slaveholding societies in the hemisphere, especially Cuba, Brazil, and the Independent Republic of Texas. Sometimes, as with Texas in 1845, protecting slavery required annexing new territory. On other occasions, as in Cuba in 1843 or 1854, it involved a more restrained policy of pro-slavery solidarity and cooperation. In virtually every situation, however, the preservation of slave institutions took priority over the acquisition of new land. Territorial expansion was only one tactical option on a larger strategic menu, a more comprehensive foreign policy agenda that contemporary opponents of bondage, including Karl Marx, rightly identified as armed propaganda for slavery abroad. The most spectacular examples of this armed propaganda were the filibuster invasions of Latin America. Between 1848 and 1860, a handful of lone commandos in the United States raised private armies to attack Cuba, Mexico, and Nicaragua, often with the stated goal of expanding the domain of slavery. These swashbuckling imperialists have claimed a large share of historical attention, even though their efforts universally ended in disaster. This book takes a different approach. It concentrates not on private filibusters, but on the much more powerful and only occasionally less flamboyant Southern elites in charge of the U.S. government. It was these slaveholders, after all, weighty statesmen, not wild-eyed soldiers of fortune, who acquired Texas, protected slavery in Cuba, and oversaw the conquest of Mexico. For nearly two full decades, these men organized U.S. foreign relations around what might fairly be called a foreign policy of slavery. To be sure, slaveholding leaders did not always agree on their objectives abroad. Frequently, on questions of national politics, they quarreled among themselves at home. Yet for all the political fault lines that divided the antebellum Southern elite, it would be misleading to view master-class foreign policy as a chaos of colliding egos, regional splits, and partisan feuds. In fact, a broad and powerful combination of Southern elites, from Andrew Jackson and John Tyler to Jefferson Davis and Alexander Stevens, insisted on the centrality of slavery in American international relations. Equally important, these elites insisted on an essential unity between the slave South and the rest of the nation. Amid the 1844 debates over Texas annexation, the Richmond Inquirer published a letter from a particularly hot-tempered Central Virginia correspondent. C.R. Fontaine had just organized a pro-Texas public meeting in Buckingham County, and he wrote to denounce the anti-slavery opponents of annexation as base and villainous agitators. Former President John Quincy Adams, the most outspoken national critic of Texas and slavery, provoked Fontaine's special fury. This hyena in human shape, he alleged, hoped to trigger a civil war and spread butchery, murder, and rapine across the land. Yet Fontaine was assured that such disunionist fanatics would not succeed in bringing about the ruin of this vast Southern empire. To thwart this terrible fate, he predicted plenty of Americans, North, South, and West, would leap to defend the nation by rescuing Texas from the unhallowed hands of England. Throughout the antebellum period, the slaveholding statesmen at the helm of U.S. foreign policy generally shared Fontaine's worldview. Very often, they also shared his opinion of John Quincy Adams. Their imperial imagination was not narrowly sectional or separatist. Their pro-slavery zeal did not diminish their national patriotism. As leaders like Calhoun and Davis worked to strengthen bondage both at home and abroad, they understood themselves in command not of a mere region or a section, but a mighty world power. From their international perspective, this vast Southern empire was quite simply the United States. The mid-century struggle between bondage and freedom began in earnest with the emancipation of the British West Indies in 1833. The world's leading economic and naval power, American slaveholding leaders now believed, had determined to wage a global war on servitude. Chapter 1 recounts how slaveholders came to see a vigorous and assertive U.S. foreign policy as necessary to combat Great Britain's imperial abolitionism. Southern-led efforts to reform and expand the U.S. Navy, chronicled in Chapter 2, make sense only when they are viewed in the light of this emerging foreign policy of slavery. And although historians have long understood antebellum expansion in terms of the sectional struggle over the balance of power in Congress, Chapters 3 and 4 explore the ways in which Southerners were often equally concerned with the balance of power in the Western Hemisphere. Identifying the United States as the chief hemispheric champion of slavery, Southerners sought to defend the security of vulnerable slaveholding regimes across the Americas, from Brazil to Cuba. Their struggle to protect slavery in the Republic of Texas led to the U.S. war with Mexico, which, as Chapter 5 describes, brought about the massive enlargement and consolidation of an effectively pro-slavery American continental empire. After the triumphant war with Mexico, slaveholding leaders assumed a confident posture in foreign affairs. The anti-slavery energies of Great Britain appeared to be receding, while the pro-slavery imperialism of the United States grew stronger than ever. Yet in these same years, a surging domestic reaction against possible spread of slavery threatened slaveholders' power in Washington. This contradiction of the 1850s, slaveholders growing more confident abroad but becoming more beleaguered at home, frames the second half of the book. Chapters 6 and 7 explore slaveholders' deep conviction that the world economy depended on slave-grown staple agriculture, not just King Cotton, as they famously boasted, but the other vassals of emperor slavery, including Cuban sugar and Brazilian coffee. European states, slaveholders argued, had become disillusioned by the experience of slave emancipation. The global spread of colonial empires and coolie labor systems reflected a general acceptance that racial hierarchy and bound labor were necessary elements of modern civilization. Chapters 8 and 9 examine how this broader pro-slavery worldview informed the actual workings of American foreign policy in the 1850s, which sought continually to protect slave institutions across the hemisphere. And even as sectional arguments corroded domestic politics, pro-slavery leaders worked as hard as ever to enhance the power of the U.S. military. Southern secession itself, Chapter 10 argues, was a kind of foreign policy decision. The election of an anti-slavery president snapped the last and strongest bonds connecting the South to the Union. Access, through the executive branch, to foreign affairs, the Army, and the Navy, deprived of any further investment in the United States' international clout, Southern elites found the appeal of an independent career irresistible. In the Civil War that followed, their slaveholding Confederacy was utterly defeated, yet in some ways, as W.E.B. Du Bois argued a full generation later, American slaveholders bequeathed a legacy that outlived even the destruction of slavery and found echoes far beyond the American South. Selected to give a lecture at Harvard's 1890 commencement ceremonies, Du Bois titled his address, Jefferson Davis as a Representative of Civilization. Davis and the antebellum masterclass were long gone, but key elements of the global order they envisioned, based on white supremacy, coerced labor, and aggressive state power, continued to shape world politics at the turn of the 20th century. 1. Confronting the Great Apostle of Emancipation. In the summer of 1836, Nathaniel Beverly Tucker had every reason to be delighted with his budding literary career. After 15 years as a circuit court judge in Missouri, in 1833, Tucker returned to his native Virginia to accept an academic post at the College of William and Mary. Thus comfortably installed in Williamsburg, the 50-year-old law professor turned his attention to the writing of novels. First, he published George Balcombe, a frontier romance whose vigorous plotting and shrewd characterizations impressed critics more than its delicacy of style. With the mere English, some occasional and trivial faults may be found. Perhaps it would have been better to avoid such pure technicalities as anastomosing, noted Edgar Allan Poe, who nevertheless praised the book as the best American novel yet written. Now Tucker had completed his second novel, a work of much greater formal ambition. The Partisan Leader was set 13 years in the future, and reflected Tucker's lifelong immersion in Southern separatist politics. Equal parts cautionary tale and wish-fulfillment fantasy, the novel imagined a civil war between an independent Southern Confederacy and a despotic Northern rump state ruled by Martin Van Buren. In Tucker's vision of 1849, Virginia finds itself caught between the sovereign Lower South and the power-mad Van Buren regime, which has imposed an odious tariff on all agricultural exports. Pushed to their limits by Northern cupidity and Northern fanaticism, a heroic band of Virginia partisans fights off Van Buren's invading army and averts the plunder and desolation of the South. Tucker's first novel had been published by Harper & Brothers in New York, but for the partisan leader, he turned to the veteran journalist and Washington insider Duff Green. Like Tucker, Green emerged from family roots in Virginia, went on to a public career in Missouri, and maintained a firm devotion to the interests of slaveholders throughout the Union. But while Tucker cultivated the style of an independent intellectual, conservative scholar, jurist, and man of letters, Green was a thoroughly political animal. As editor of the United States Telegraph, Green had masterminded media strategy during Andrew Jackson's 1828 presidential campaign. Bound by intimate ideological and marital ties to South Carolina's John C. Calhoun, his daughter married Calhoun's son, he later broke with Jackson, but remained one of the most influential pro-slavery operators in Washington. In September 1836, Green wrote Tucker to notify him of the book's forthcoming appearance in print, chiding his author on one major point. "The defect in your plot is that you have made the tariff the prominent idea, when I think you should make the slave question the basis of your supposed separation." Green recommended adding a chapter showing the interest which Great Britain has in substituting the cotton of the East Indies for the cotton of our South Atlantic states. This international threat to Southern slavery and Southern produce, Green believed, represented a far greater danger than the merely domestic wickedness of Martin Van Buren and his allies in the North. Certainly it warranted a mention in Tucker's story. Great Britain's larger scheme of mercantile and mechanical cupidity might be demonstrated in a commentary by some character, either from the North or the South, Green suggested, helpfully referring Tucker to a series of recent British parliamentary debates, in case the author wanted original source material to cite. The publisher's attempt at criticism revealed, somewhat comically, the limits of his artistic imagination. Like his patron Calhoun, Green might well have tried to begin a poem with whereas and then stopped. But this literary dispute also contained a world of political meaning. After the South actually seceded from the Union 25 years later, a New York publishing house reprinted the partisan leader with the subtitle "A Key to the Disunion Conspiracy." But perhaps the novel's most visionary achievement was not its prophecy of secession, but its portrait of a South that could secede for purely domestic and economic reasons. By emphasizing the tariff rather than the slave question, Tucker presented a version of the sectional crisis that anticipated the South's post-Civil War justification of its antebellum history. The partisan leader's melodrama of commercial rivalry, sectional rancor, and local patriotism foreshadowed the Southern imagination of 1881, not 1861. In fact, as Duff Green's criticism made clear, this perspective struck important Southern contemporaries as oddly incomplete. During much of the antebellum period, it was Green rather than Tucker who best captured the dominant political orientation of the elite South. This Southern leadership was ambitious and cosmopolitan, not defensive and provincial. It was explicit rather than implicit about the importance of slave labor both at home and abroad. While Tucker could see Great Britain only as a possible commercial ally of an independent South, Green's keen and roving eye kept close watch not only on foreign tariff rates, but also on the larger international politics of slavery. For many powerful antebellum slaveholders, British imperialism and anti-slavery were as dangerous to the South as national tariff policy or Northern abolitionism. In his revisions of the partisan leader, Tucker declined to take Green's literary advice. Even the author of George Balcombe was reluctant to reshape his novel around a character who specialized in the extended quotation of parliamentary debates. But other and more influential Southern elites soon came to share Greene's interpretation of British foreign policy. Within a decade, nearly all the dominant figures in the South's national political leadership, from Jackson to Calhoun, understood British motives in a similar light. Britain's ambition to control the global market for cotton, these leaders believed, had spawned a crusade for slave abolition throughout the Western Hemisphere and represented a direct threat to slavery in the United States. This modern Black Crusade. After years of public agitation and parliamentary debate, in August 1833, the British government outlawed slavery in its West Indian possessions. For U.S. abolitionists, this act of emancipation, which eventually freed over 800,000 people, represented a watershed victory in the global struggle against bondage. But opponents of slavery were not the only Americans paying attention. Southern slaveholders, too, followed the news from London. Ultimately, British emancipation would transform the way Southern elites thought about foreign affairs more forcefully than any other global event between the American Revolution and the Civil War. To be sure, Southern statesmen had drawn connections between slavery and U.S. foreign relations long before 1833. A marked concern for slave property shaped American diplomacy in the negotiations that ended the Revolutionary War and the War of 1812. Southern fears about slave insurrection and race war strongly influenced U.S. policy toward the rebellious French colony of Saint-Domingue, and later the independent Black nation of Haiti. In the 1810s, Presidents James Madison and James Monroe, along with General Andrew Jackson, used overwhelming force to destroy Black Maroon settlements in Spanish Florida, extending the area for secure slaveholding settlement. Indeed, the rapid spread of slave labor plantations into the North American continental interior, from Alabama to Missouri, was achieved equally through the lure of agricultural profits and the firm protections of state power. All this federal support for slavery, however, did not imply a coherent strategic worldview. Southern leaders in the early Republic were concerned with the security of slave property on the southwestern frontier and anxious about the prospect of another Haitian revolution spreading to American shores. But they saw no reason to organize all U.S. foreign policy around the defense of bondage. From the disputed presidential election of 1800 to the Missouri crisis of 1819-1821, the question of slavery was seldom far from center stage in national politics. But in the major foreign policy debates of the era, slavery played a more ambiguous role. Few Southern leaders applied a consistent pro-slavery framework to transatlantic or hemispheric affairs. When Spain's Latin American provinces revolted in the 1810s and 1820s, U.S. slaveholding elites generally embraced their struggles for independence and republican government, even when those struggles involved the emancipation of slaves. The Panama Congress of 1826 marked a turning point in both Southern and national attitudes toward international slavery. President John Quincy Adams endorsed U.S. participation in the conference, which had been organized by Simon Bolivar, to encourage political and economic goodwill across the newly independent hemisphere. But a block of mostly Southern legislators objected to any direct engagement with the racially mixed Latin American governments. Virginia Senator John Randolph shrank from the horror of a U.S. diplomat taking his seat in the Congress beside the native African, their American descendants, the mixed breeds, the Indians, and the half-breeds, without any offense or scandal at so motley a mixture. Worse yet, the new regimes in Colombia, Mexico, and elsewhere manifested too much sympathy for free Black Haiti and too much hostility toward slaveholding Spanish Cuba. A Haitian-aided invasion of Cuba and Puerto Rico, rumored to be under discussion at the meeting in Panama City, might bring the nightmare of race war even closer to American shores. With a due regard to the safety of the Southern states, Georgia's John Berrien asked rhetorically, can you suffer these islands to pass into the hands of buccaneers, drunk with their newborn liberty? The United States, Randolph reminded the Senate, could be invaded from Cuba in rowboats. The debate over the Panama Congress announced the breakdown of the Monroe Doctrine consensus in foreign policy, the rise of aggressive white supremacist rhetoric in national politics, and perhaps most important, the arrival of an organized opposition that would grow into the Jacksonian Democratic Party. In foreign affairs, the Southern leadership of this new coalition demonstrated a greater sensitivity to hemispheric slavery, and perhaps a greater willingness to muster U.S. power on its behalf than the Jeffersonians before them. Virginia's John Floyd was not the only Southern legislator willing to take up arms to prevent Cuban emancipation, but most anti-Panama Congress Southerners did not think that arms would be necessary. Protecting slavery in Cuba required little more than a firm stand against a few small and divided nations in Latin America. It did not entail a collision with a major European power, let alone a larger reorganization of U.S. foreign policy. In fact, slaveholding leaders in the 1820s generally expressed satisfaction with the existing balance of power in the Western Hemisphere. With the final defeat of Napoleon and the disintegration of the Spanish Empire, the Atlantic world was dominated more than ever by the power of Great Britain. Like other Americans, Southerners expressed their share of hostility toward Britain, the nation that Thomas Jefferson had famously called our only natural enemies. Yet in the two decades after the War of 1812, there were many reasons for Southern statesmen to view British power with acceptance rather than alarm. After all, Britain had become by far America's most important trading partner and most generous foreign investor. The cotton boom that was remaking the American Southwest in slavery's image depended heavily on the growth of the British textile industry. By 1830, over two-thirds of U.S. cotton exports went to Britain. Although some Southerners followed Henry Clay in hoping that the United States might escape the commercial dominion of Great Britain, through tariff protections, most planter elites looked agreeably on the Anglo-American economic relationship. If anything, they sought fewer trade restrictions and a more intimate commercial exchange with Britain. Under these circumstances, it was no surprise that the logic of Anglo-American strategic cooperation often appealed to Southern leaders. In 1823, when British Foreign Secretary George Canning proposed a united declaration against possible European interference in Latin America, Secretary of War Calhoun and other influential Southerners urged President Monroe to accept the offer. Jefferson put aside his lifelong distrust of Britain in hopes of building an Anglo-American partnership that might defend free government from Greece to Argentina. With the British fleets and fiscal resources associated with our own, declared Madison, we should be safe against the rest of the world. It was Secretary of State John Quincy Adams, a Massachusetts man, who persuaded Monroe to forego Canning's joint declaration and issue the unilateral state paper that would become known as the Monroe Doctrine. During the Panama debates 3 years later, many slaveholding elites still looked to Great Britain as a helpfully conservative force in a turbulent region. For South Carolina Congressman James Hamilton, a French or British seizure of Cuba would be inconvenient, but unlike a Mexican or Colombian invasion, it would be attended with no violent concussion. Either European power would have the naval and military means to coerce the brigands and blacks into peace and submission. The key to this comforting calculus, as John Floyd noted, was Britain's ongoing commitment to slavery. The British West Indies contained 600,000 to 700,000 of slaves, which, if the doctrine inculcated by these new Republicans prevail, will be incited to rebellion. It would be nothing short of folly to believe that Britain would jeopardize these territories or permit them to be torn from her by revolution. Less than a decade later, a political revolution in London ended slavery in the British West Indies for good. John Randolph, perhaps alone among the anti-Panama Southerners, had seen this coming as early as 1826. Over the past several years, he told Congress during the Panama debates, a total change has taken place in public opinion in Great Britain. The progress of anti-slavery sentiment in Old England worried Randolph as much as any Caribbean uprising or New World emancipation. There could be no end to this modern black crusade, as he called it, but a war against slavery throughout the Americas. 7 years later, in May 1833, Parliament passed the Slavery Abolition Act. Great Britain's decision to free its Caribbean slaves changed the basic order of things in the Western Hemisphere. The world's most powerful nation had now begun to organize its considerable economic, diplomatic, and military resources in opposition to one of American society's most fundamental institutions. The modern Black Crusade had reached its Jerusalem. What would the United States do about it? The Abolition Act of 1833 softened its blow to West Indian planters in a number of ways. Britain's approximately 800,000 slaves were not freed all at once. They would remain apprentices, formally bound to their masters for a term of 4 to 6 years. Meanwhile, 3,000 British planters received £20 million in compensation, an enormous sum, roughly equivalent to 4 times the annual budget of the Royal Navy. For American slaveholders, however, none of these concessions outweighed the essential fact of emancipation itself. An aggressive anti-slavery lobby in Britain had won control of Parliament and had ended bondage through legislative fiat. From an American perspective, one political lesson of the British experience was clear. The security of slavery depended on proximity to national power. On this score, South Carolina and Louisiana planters maintained a much stronger position than their counterparts in Jamaica or Barbados. By 1833, slaveholding elites had occupied the U.S. presidency for all but 8 of the past 45 years. Even more important, the evolution of the second party system in the 1820s, in which both Whigs and Democrats competed for votes in the North and the South, effectively removed anti-slavery voices from the national political debate. Nevertheless, the precedent of British emancipation left a significant imprint on American politics. Over the course of the next decade, it set the tone for the South's emerging defense of slavery, while stiffening Southern resistance to even the faintest hint of anti-slavery activity in Congress. The international implications of British emancipation were even more profound. The specter of freedom in the West Indies, Southern elites feared, would come to haunt slavery in the United States. Between Haiti and the British Islands, the South Carolina intellectual Hugh Swinton Legare calculated the Caribbean was now home to a black population of some 2 million free from all restraint and ready for any mischief. The simple presence of so many freed people in the West Indies represented an intrinsic threat to the American system of bondage. Southern slaveholders, one Charleston newspaper urged, must counteract the influence which it is supposed the English project will necessarily have. 2 years after Nat Turner's bloody rebellion in Virginia, and just over a decade after Denmark Vesey's conspiracy in Charleston, American slaveholders well understood the mischief that could result when enslaved people encountered the influence of freedom. Just as fundamentally, British emancipation transformed the geopolitical struggle over slavery throughout the Atlantic world. Across the Western Hemisphere in the Age of Revolution, the greatest victories for abolition were generally won by shifting alliances of local actors, bondspeople themselves, free people of color, and sympathetic Creole elites. This combination of forces, as slaveholders like Hugh Legare understood, was potent enough. Certainly, colonial pressure from below had played an important role in British emancipation. Yet with the partial and temporary exception of revolutionary France, until 1833, the opponents of slavery had not received the support of any great Atlantic power. As a result, they had often lacked the economic resources, military might, and naval capacity that only a major state could provide. The Abolition Act thus represented a literal sea change in the balance of power between slavery and freedom in the Atlantic world. To be sure, after 1833, Great Britain did not immediately reorganize its entire overseas policy around the destruction of slavery in the Western Hemisphere. But when questions involving bondage bled into international relations, the representatives of British power, colonial officials, consular agents, and Royal Navy commanders now generally lined up on the side of the slaves. Inevitably, this put Great Britain on a collision course with the most powerful slaveholding society in the hemisphere, the United States. The first major post-emancipation clash between the two nations involved 3 American slave ships that ventured into British waters in the early 1830s. The Comet, the Encomium, and the Enterprise were engaged in the coastwise slave trade that stretched from Virginia to Louisiana. All 3 were either stranded by storms or wrecked near Bermuda. In each case, local British authorities freed the enslaved people on board. For years, U.S. officials remonstrated with the British government in London, demanding compensation for the slave property they believed had been unlawfully taken from American owners. In January 1837, British Foreign Secretary Lord Palmerston at last issued a formal response. While hinting that he might compromise on the Comet and Encomium cases, Palmerston declared that Britain would not compensate the owners of the slaves aboard the Enterprise. Palmerston contended that since the ship docked in Bermuda after August 1, 1834, when the Abolition Act took effect, slavery was illegal in the West Indies and there could be no reimbursement for illegal property. Naturally, this verdict did not sit well with American leaders, least of all the U.S. minister in London, Andrew Stevenson. A prominent lawyer and planter in Tidewater, Virginia, Stevenson had represented the Richmond District in Congress and had served as Speaker of the House from 1827 to 1834. In London, he would also become antebellum America's first major pro-slavery diplomat. Before Palmerston announced the British position on the shipwrecked slaves, Stevenson had written the Foreign Secretary with his government's views. There could be no distinction in principle between property in persons and property in things, he argued. Any British attempt to impose such a distinction in the Comet, Encomium, and Enterprise cases would be understood by the American government as a violation of international law. When or where has the doctrine ever been established, Stevenson asked with rhetorical confidence, that slavery was prohibited or contrary to the law of nations? Freedom was still the exception. Slavery remained the norm. U.S. Secretary of State John Forsyth, a former governor of Georgia, took the same position. British emancipation had altered the municipal law of the West Indies, not the status of slavery in an international context. In fact, both U.S. officials argued, the celebrated Abolition Act had not really ended bondage at all. By law, adult West Indian slaves were to become apprentices bound to their masters until 1838 or 1840. Forsyth argued that this scheme could not be distinguished from slavery itself. Many northern states, after all, had passed laws of gradual emancipation, but none of them were so audacious as to pretend that bound laborers, as long as they were not yet free, were anything but slaves. These slaveholding American diplomats had begun to feel the international reverberations produced by Great Britain's turn against bondage. For Stevenson, the principles and doctrines asserted by Lord Palmerston raised matters of higher and deeper importances connected with the national interest and institutions of the whole United States. Forsyth felt especially concerned about Palmerston's affirmation that slavery, under any circumstances, could never exist on British colonial territory. This gave American slaves the strongest inducement to flight or abduction. The U.S. government had no choice but to see this position as evidence of a spirit hostile to the repose and security of the United States. British anti-slavery, in other words, threatened the safety of American slaveholders and thus the very foundation of Anglo-American peace. Stevenson delved even deeper into the troubling legal implications of Britain's statement on the Enterprise case. Palmerston's ruling presupposed not merely that slavery for life has been abolished within the British dominions, but that human beings cannot be the subject of property, anywhere or to any extent. Stevenson declared that this proposition could not be maintained by a British government whose laws were founded on the previous right of property in slaves for life. The American minister verged on declaring British abolition itself a violation of international law. The denial of a right to slavery anywhere, he implied, was a denial of a right to slavery everywhere. Although Stevenson did not lean hard on this pro-slavery principle, a kind of international precursor to the logic of the Dred Scott ruling in 1857, the fact that he even transmitted it to Palmerston reflected his concern with the implications of the British turn against slavery. But although Forsyth and Stevenson had effectively constructed a pro-slavery interpretation of international law, they did not formulate a pro-slavery interpretation of Atlantic geopolitics. Despite their warnings that British abolitionism would threaten the national interest and institutions of the United States, neither the minister in London nor the Secretary of State proposed directing American foreign policy to safeguard those vital institutions. The correspondence over the enterprise constituted the beginning of the South's confrontation with British anti-slavery, but only the beginning. It required a genuine war scare for slaveholders to grapple with the new alignment of forces across the hemisphere. In 1837, British colonial officials decided to act against American traders who were supplying arms to Canadian rebels against the Crown. The British seized and burned the ship Caroline in a western New York harbor, killing one American and provoking a demand for reparations from President Martin Van Buren. Later, the 1838-39 Aroostook War erupted on the disputed boundary line between Maine and New Brunswick. No Americans were killed in these informal hostilities, but Northeastern representatives in Washington demanded that the government act to secure the Maine frontier. In February 1839, Congress approved a bill that gave President Van Buren additional powers for the defense of the United States, including funds for a volunteer army of up to 50,000 men. The tensions along the northeastern boundary were soothed before any serious military collision could occur. But the prospect of an Anglo-American war was real enough for slaveholders to contemplate its implications. "We are on the eve of hostilities with that very country which is the center and source of anti-slavery fanaticism," warned a contributor to the Richmond Enquirer in 1840. "In such an event, will not an appeal be made to our slaves and arms be put in their hands? The entire country between Maryland and Louisiana," implied South Carolina Congressman Francis Pickens, "could be turned into a howling wilderness wrapped in conflagration." War with Britain now involved not merely the risk of battlefield defeat, but the nightmarish possibility of slave rebellion and mass emancipation. No wonder Southern leaders often took dovish positions on the northeastern border feuds. In the aftermath of the Caroline affair, John C. Calhoun urged Congress to avoid aggravating tensions with London. In 1840, Virginia Congressman Henry Wise mocked the idea of waging war over a few old pine logs in Maine. The United States was simply not prepared to enter an armed conflict with a major anti-slavery power, and the social consequences of such a conflict were almost too terrifying to imagine. But if many Southerners agreed that it was critical to avoid war with Britain in the short term, the broader strategic implications were less certain. After 1840, Southern leaders increasingly began to view all global politics through the lens of America's commitment to slavery and Great Britain's commitment to abolition. In these years, there was plenty of British global activity on view. Between 1839 and 1841, Britain fought significant war in Afghanistan, launched a major naval expedition against Qing China, and intervened in the Turkish-Egyptian conflict in Syria. American slaveholding elites noted all these distant confrontations and accumulations of the expanding British Empire. In a letter to Calhoun, the South Carolina planter politician James Henry Hammond blasted Britain's opium war in China, expressing the somewhat quixotic hope that the United States would send a strong squadron there under a firm officer to protect American interests in the area. Few regions of the globe were too remote to warrant attention from Southern leaders. At his post in London, Andrew Stevenson worried about extension of the authority of the British government to New Zealand, which might affect American commercial interests in the Pacific. A strong distaste for British imperialism was hardly unique to Southern slaveholders. New England whalers feared British control over the Pacific. New York merchants hoped for an increasing American share of the China trade. And many Americans in different regions criticized British empire building in Asia. What distinguished elite Southerners in this period was their tendency to connect British imperialism to British anti-slavery. In Southern eyes, the philanthropic motive for West Indian emancipation was belied, or at least outweighed, by Britain's grasping disposition in world affairs. The humanitarian pretensions of British abolitionists rang hollow in a world dominated by British imperial power. "The Queen of England," snapped one Southern editor with defiant irony, "is the largest slaveholder in the world." In March 1840, Calhoun gave a speech in the Senate that crystallized some themes of the evolving Southern critique. The South Carolinian observed that Britain's anti-slavery position in international law could be justified only by one of two larger premises, both dangerously grandiose. Either Britain asserted that her municipal laws against slavery are paramount to the laws of nations, or that slavery, the right of man to hold property in man, is against the law of nations. In the former case, the British government would be virtually abolishing the entire system of international laws. More likely, however, Britain had chosen the latter course, and flouting centuries of legal precedent and established custom, now sought to destroy the property rights of slaveholders all across the Atlantic world. Moving beyond international law, Calhoun attempted to take stock of Great Britain's bizarre conduct around the globe. On the one hand, British politicians boasted about slave abolition in the West Indies. On the other, they organized a brutal invasion of Afghanistan and violently forced Indian opium into the Chinese market. For Calhoun, the scale of British hypocrisy was simply staggering. There never before existed on this globe a nation that presented such a spectacle as Great Britain does at this moment. She seems to be actuated under the most opposite and conflicting motives. While apparently actuated by so much zeal on this side of the Cape of Good Hope in the cause of humanity and liberty, she appears to be actuated on the other side by a spirit of conquest and domination not surpassed by Rome in the haughtiest days of the Republic. Leaving aside the question of how such an eccentric policy had developed, Calhoun predicted that it could end only in ruin. If it was contrary to the laws of nature or of nations for man to hold man in subjection, how could the British government justify its rule over Ireland? Britain could not forever promote a principle, the emancipation and liberation of enslaved peoples, that struck so directly at the foundations of its mighty power. Even within England itself, the rising Chartist movement showed that a struggle against social or political slavery once begun could not easily be contained. Calhoun urged Britain to abandon its abolitionist crusade before it resulted in the utter overthrow of the present political system of Great Britain and the rest of Europe. Calhoun's political warning joined other Southern arguments about the immediate dangers of militarized British imperialism in North America. As the Virginia-born U.S. consul in Jamaica, Robert Monroe Harrison wrote to Secretary of State Daniel Webster, Britain had recently crushed Muhammad Ali, frightened John Chinaman out of his wits, and put down insurrection in her India possessions. What was to prevent this hostile abolitionist empire from landing upwards of 200,000 blacks from the West Indies on the southern coast? A range of southern political leaders began to link British imperial anti-slavery and American strategic vulnerability. In August 1840, Secretary of State Forsyth told a Georgia audience that only President Van Buren and the Democratic Party could defend Southern slaveholders from the menace of political abolitionism. Such recourse to the politics of slavery was not new during a presidential campaign, but Forsyth's speech took special pains to emphasize the international threat to bound labor. He accused Great Britain of converting all the West Indies into places of refuge for escaped slaves, dispatching commissioners to Havana to scrutinize American commerce and organizing anti-slavery black regiments through the enlistment of recaptured Africans. Van Buren and the Democrats, Forsyth promised, would protect the slave South from British interference far more energetically than the Anglophile elites in the Whig Party. In a domestic setting where the second party system had successfully barred anti-slavery voices from mainstream politics, the most fearsome enemies of bondage came from outside American borders. The tiny and marginalized community of New England abolitionists loomed large in Southern imaginations after 1833, precisely because its radical program had an ally in the world's most powerful empire. Whatever their numbers, declared the Richmond Enquirer, the abolitionists could not be a contemptible sect, either at home or abroad. They have emancipated against the will of their owners slaves of the West Indies and the Mauritius. Now, through the formidable mechanism of British power, they aimed a blow at the United States. This line of thought did not wither away after the 1840 election. In February 1841, Francis Pickens, now chairman of the House Committee on Foreign Affairs, delivered a comprehensive report on the state of Anglo-American relations. Imperial Britain's forward march appeared unstoppable, from its naval victory in Syria, which gave Britain ascendancy on the Mediterranean and the Levant, to its recent movements in the China Seas and islands, indicating a British disposition to subjugate the whole of Asia. Pickens pointed ominously to Britain's considerable holdings in the Western Hemisphere, tracing an arc all the way from Falkland Island through the Caribbean and up to Nova Scotia. Considering Britain's anti-slavery zeal, her growing power in the West Indies represented a real threat to American security. The danger was especially grave for near one half the states of this Confederacy, the slaveholding South. Pickens still dreaded the prospect of a war with Britain, but since the Maine crisis in 1839, he had grown much more concerned about the urgency of the British threat and much more willing to use American power to repel it. 2 years earlier, he had opposed a 20,000-man provisional army to defend the northeastern border. Now he urged Congress to begin a wise preparation of the armed forces and to establish an enlightened system of national defense suited to the exigencies of the time. In November 1841, Great Britain and the United States again butted heads over a wayward American slave ship. This time, the culprit was not a storm in the Bermuda Triangle, but the enslaved passengers themselves. On October 31st, the American brig Creole left Hampton Roads, Virginia, bound for New Orleans with a cargo of 135 slaves. Just 1 week into the voyage, 19 slaves on board rebelled, seized control of the ship, and forced the surviving crew to pilot it into Nassau Harbor in the Bahamas. British officials freed most of the slaves immediately, and after consulting with London, released the mutineers a few months later. When word of the revolt news reached American shores, Southern outrage at British abolitionism rose to new heights. The Mississippi State Legislature knew exactly where to place the blame. The doctrine of universal emancipation, now so acceptable to the rulers and the ruled of Great Britain, certainly stirred up these rebellious slaves to mutiny and murder. In Congress, prominent Southerners reacted with differing degrees of belligerence. But virtually all of them agreed with Calhoun, who declared that Britain's current anti-slavery policy was the most dangerous innovation on national rights and national honor ever claimed by one independent power of another. Between 1836 and 1841, leading Southern editors and politicians had gradually come to reckon with the geopolitical consequences of British emancipation. Philanthropy, Virginia Senator John Tyler had declared in 1838, when separated from policy, is the most dangerous agent in human affairs. For Calhoun, Pickens, and other Southerners in 1840, the reverse was proving to be the case. Abolitionist philanthropy, when joined to policy, especially British imperial foreign policy, was proving an even more dangerous agent. Many Southern critics, however, still ceded to Great Britain a sort of perverse moral high ground. West Indian emancipation, however irresponsible and dangerous, at least grew out of a genuine philanthropic impulse. Calhoun himself granted that in the Western Hemisphere, at least Britain's rulers sincerely believed that they were serving the cause of humanity and liberty. Of course, Britain's ruthless exploitation of Asia cast doubt on its inherent benevolence, but here Calhoun charged hypocrisy, not deception. As yet, neither he nor most other leading Southern statesmen claimed to understand why Britain had embraced Western emancipation and Eastern imperialism at the same time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.